Hey guys, we're going to take another look at some history today, and today's topic is going to be westward expansion. So often we think of westward expansion, or the Great Wild West, if you will. We think about, you know, wagon trains and John Wayne and cowboys, maybe terrible Will Smith movies, shoot at the OK Corral, you know, people sitting around singing stuff like home, home on the range, where the deer and the antelope play, all that kind of stuff. But we're going to see how it really, really was. And one of the big reasons people went out west was for the Homestead Act. It was a law passed in 1862 during the Civil War that said, okay, we have all this open space out west. And if you remember that map we looked at, how densely populated the eastern part of the country was and how the west wasn't really populated at all. And that Homestead Act basically said, hey, we will give away 160 free acres of land to anybody who wants it, who, one, move out west, and two, do one thing. And that is improve the land. That could mean build a farm, build a fence, build a well, whatever it was. You had to make some kind of improvement to the land. And so almost 600,000 people after the Civil War become what's called a homesteader. Packed up all their stuff and headed out west to build a new life, a new farm, some kind of new way of doing things. So you see an example of a homesteader here. You kind of see the idea of the wagons all headed west. In some cases, people got there too early. Oklahoma is called the Sooner State because people got there too soon, even before the land was allowed open, and they just ended up staying there. I guess it was kind of funny when these happened because people would just kind of line up on the line, and just when the administrator, the government guy, said, go, pick your piece of land, people just rushed there and ran and tried to get us to a piece of land to claim their spot as quickly as they could. It was almost like a Black Friday at a department store after Thanksgiving. It was almost kind of the same exact thing. Some of the other people who do this were also called Exodusers. Exodusers were African Americans who moved west. They decided to get away from the Black codes, all bad things happening in the South, and make a new life for themselves out west. Now, think about the impact here of this. Impact is that there's a mass migration of people headed out west. We're talking millions of people decided to pack up their stuff and go out west, build new homes, build fences, build farms. And essentially, that western part of the country isn't the frontier anymore. It now becomes a new part of the world. It becomes more connected, and we start seeing kind of that big, vast plains not be the big, vast plains anymore. And so that end of that frontier happens during this time period. Now, people get out there, they got to find a place to live, obviously. And if you've ever been out on the Great Plains of Kansas, Nebraska, and that area, you know there aren't many trees. It's a big plain. It's grassland is what it really was. And yet, so there's no trees, no wood. How are you going to build a house? They built soddies. Soddies were sod homes. You would cut basically bricks of sod out of the grass and stack them up to make your house until you could bring wood or other materials in to build a house. Sometimes they were dug out the side of the hill, like this one. Sometimes they were, you know, just a sod house like this. And it was kind of cool, I guess, the grass would kind of grow together, and it would be pretty solid, actually. And they're actually really, really practical because they're super cool in the summer. That cold dirt, cold sod, cold grass made these houses really nice and cool in the summertime, so it didn't get so hot. And then in the wintertime, they're nice and warm because the walls were thick. It kept the snow and the rain and the wind out, those kind of things. Well, it really didn't keep the rain out. If you think about it, when rain hits dirt, it makes mud. And so when it rained on the plains, that mud didn't really help too much. Also, a little scary part of this, the animals like to hide in the walls, things like snakes, rats, those kind of critters. And so, you know, it wasn't exactly, you know, all nice that way. And lastly, if there's no wood to build a house, obviously there's also no wood to build a fire. And so what they burn to fuel their home, you know, heat their homes and cook their food was not wood, but in fact it was animal dung. It was called the buffalo chip. They would find, you know, dried buffalo dung, cow chips, those kind of things, and use them to actually fuel their stoves and fuel their fire. So yeah, I mean, you know, if you like the smell of animal dung for your food, I guess it was pretty good. But it was definitely a way you would do with what you had out there, and that's kind of what part of living out there was. So there's actually really huge farms out there called bonanza farms. These farms are sometimes 15,000 to 60,000 acres. It's an old TV show, so same name, Bonanza. The idea was that the more crops you had, the more money you'd make. It's pretty simple, right? If I'm going to grow wheat or grow corn, the more I grow, the more money I'm going to make. Here's the problem. The more crops they grew, the more the price went down. It's the idea of supply and demand. The more something there is, the less price you're going to get for it. And so a lot of these farmers, as they grew more and more stuff, they had smaller and smaller prices, and they had trouble starting to pay back their debt. So a lot of these big, huge farms went under, while some of the little farms were actually pretty successful. One of the things that also creates during this time is the Transcontinental Railroad. You know, if you look at this railroad map here, there are a lot of railroads over here in the eastern part, especially in the north, connecting places from New York to, Cleveland, Chicago, all those kind of places. But out west here, there wasn't much at all. You had to take a wagon, you know, use the rivers, those kind of things. And so railroads started expanding west. There were two big companies. There was the Union Pacific and the Central Pacific. The Central Pacific was in the east here, starting on the other side of St. Louis, whereas the Union Pacific was out here starting in San Francisco, in California. And so the two started working on what was called the Transcontinental Railroad. One starts working over here, going towards the east. The other one started working over here, going towards the west. The goal was to meet in the middle. And eventually they did meet in the middle. They had a big ceremony. Here's a big ceremony where they took, when they met in the middle, they took this big golden spike and they drove it into the ground to say, hey, here is, you know, the where we met in the middle. It was the funniest too that the east side actually had an easier time. If you think about where they're coming from here, this side here got, it was over here in Colorado somewhere where they did this. Because over here, you're just building over flat land, going from California to go through the whole Rocky Mountains. So they had a much tougher time going from the west to the east. But really, this allowed transportation of goods, transportation of people, and made things a lot easier moving west. And honestly, most of this railroad was built by immigrants. It was a lot of Irish immigrants who built from the east. So it was a lot of Irish, Scotch-Irish, those kind of people that had come from Europe to escape issues over there. They were the big construction workers for the Central Pacific going from St. Louis towards west. And actually the big group building this railroad going from the west to the east were Chinese immigrants who came from China to California. And so we see a lot of immigration being affected here, and we'll talk about that next unit. Now one of the big downfalls of this railroad was that it really hurt some of the environment, and especially any habitat for animals like the buffalo. Because of this railroad was there, we see the buffalo herds just go all the way down. That also hurts the Native Americans that were living up there at that time. People from these trains would just, you know, stand the trains and shoot buffalo for fun just to hunt them for enjoyment. And we see the buffalo herd go from millions of buffalo in the early 1800s down to only a few hundred that were left. And it's just now recently the buffalo herds are starting to return to places like the national parks and those kind of things where the buffalo are almost hunted to extinction and destroyed because there weren't enough, because of losing the habitat and the hunting off the trains. Now, farming and ranching were two big things that happened out in this part of the world. And land that was not railroad land went into farms and ranches. So either you were setting up fields or you were raising cattle in a lot of places, or you're opening mines, which we'll talk about later on too. Farming was really influenced by technology. We'll talk more about this in class as well, but the McCormick Reaper was one of the big things that helped add to the farming out there. It was pulled by horses, and it allowed you to harvest and thresh your grain at the same time. It saved a lot of time. It was one of the big things it did. It saved a lot of time, trying to harvest, thresh the grain, basically taking the wheat stalk and getting the little parts that you use to make flour off of it. It's really funny, using this new technology here, it used to take, to get one bushel of grain in 1840, harvesting it by hand, threshing it by hand, it would take 183 minutes. So we're talking almost 3 hours it would take to harvest one bushel of grain. Using this new technology by 1890, it takes 10 minutes. So you see how much more grain you can harvest, how much more you can produce. The other thing is that this sod was on the west coast was very, very thick, very, very thick dirt. And it was, the grass had been there for so long, it was hard, very hard to tear up. And so you would take a wooden plow or an iron plow, and it would literally break an iron blade. So instead, John Deere Company created the steel plow. Now, that started in 1837, and it was improved upon later on. But the steel plow was able to rip through the sod. And they actually made the plow, this blade, this angled blade like this, to tear through that tough sod and make the furrows to plant all the crops. Before this, you know, they used basically just a hunk of iron essentially to tear up the sod. That was great for, you know, the eastern part of the country, but the western part, those iron plows just snapped. It was a steel plow that allowed the sod to be tore up and busted the sod, you will, of the west. And by the late 1800s, we have the invention of the first tractors as well. So this is exactly as actually an old tractor. Horsepower going to tractor power. They're powered by kerosene, not by diesel or by gas. But they were very, very slow. In some cases, horses were actually, faster in some cases, but this way it was, you know, a little more reliable, a little more easier to use in some cases, the first tractors that developed as well. On the other side of farming was ranching. This was where you see these people living in these cities out east. There's a huge demand for beef. I mean, there weren't a lot of farms in the cities. You couldn't keep a lot of cows. People got to eat, so the big demand for beef. And this big open land allowed a lot of area for cattle grazing, and especially the longhorn cattle. Longhorn cow can survive by itself very, very well. It doesn't need a lot of socialization, doesn't need a lot of help. It can just go out and eat grass and be happy. And so you see, you know, this idea of the cowboy developer. It was really inspired by Hispanic vaqueros who were raising cattle in Mexico and the southwestern corner of the United States. And we see all these cattle trails that develop. Usually the cattle were down here in Texas, Oklahoma, these areas, and they would basically graze all summer on the grasses, and then you actually brand the cattle during the spring roundup. So you brand the cattle, each rancher had their own unique brand. If you were caught with a cow was not your brand, get in serious trouble for that. And then you would get your group of guys together, and they would run the cattle up north in the fall. And that way you go up fall to where the railroads were, load the cattle onto railroads and take them to the butcher shops in Chicago and other places like that. The most famous one was probably the Chisholm Trail, actually. That was right here, running from Texas up to Abilene, Kansas. And then from Abilene, Kansas, they would get on railroads and then go to Chicago with their butcher and send to all the hungry people to become hamburgers and steaks and those kind of things in the big city. And so the cattle trails were a big part of the West as well. You also have the idea of cattle rustling, where, cattle were money. So, you know, people would go and steal cattle. And that idea of cattle rustling was really true, that people would steal other people's cattle, sell them for yourself, and it was one of the biggest things that would get you, you know, killed. Wasn't a lot of law enforcement out there, so a lot of vigilantes that if you did get caught doing this, you could be hung or those kind of things for, you know, stealing cattle. Eventually, an invention ended the open range, ended this idea of the cattle drive, and that was the idea of barbed wire. It was really hard to build fences to fence in all this land using wooden split rail fences. If you build fences, you know how hard that can be. But instead, barbed wire was easy to string, it was cheap, and it kept the cows and from moving off your land and kept other people from moving on your land. The cows couldn't run off anymore, people couldn't steal your cows easy, and a barbed wire in 1874 really helped end the idea of the open range and the big cattle drive. Communication also changed a lot as well. Originally, you had the idea of the mail system. That would be the Pony Express, where you people that would try to get from St. Joseph, Missouri, on the other side of St. Louis, to California in 10 days. They try to get little skinny guys who could ride on a horse and ride very, very fast, go nonstop. You would have your letter, you would hop off the horse, get to a fresh horse, and keep going every few miles. Wage was really good. If you see the poster here, the wage was $25 a week, which back then was a heck of a lot of money. There's also a good chance you would, you know, die. So that's kind of why they wanted that. They actually loved orphans, you see here, because, you know, that way there's no family to worry about. That changed when the telegraph was invented. Samuel Morse invented telegraph in 1846, sending electronic messages with dots and dashes. And they actually string these telegraphs right alongside the railroad lines. And it was a good way to get messages back and forth across the West. They even had portable telegraphs mounted on the trains in some cases. And that's the guys, remember, and we're talking about this in class, but there's a lot of myth to the West. And the Wild Wild West was not like the movies. It was not John Wayne. It was not gunfights and those kind of things. In fact, white guys carried guns more protection from animals than anything. The cowboy did not look like John Wayne. He looked more like these guys here. There were gunfights. It wasn't like a duel where guys took their 10 paces and turned and shot. It was, you know, a lot different. We'll talk more about that in class, but just remember, there's a lot of myth to the West. You know, lifestyle for these guys was working long day. I mean, 12, 14 hours a day. They're young as 15 years old, and you're alone a lot. I mean, you have all these different things you got to take care of. You're sleeping on the ground, looking after all these cows. There are African-American cowboys called Buffalo Soldiers. There are vaqueros, which are the Hispanic cowboys that are out there. And you work a lot of long hours. And these towns that popped up were raucous because guys needed to blow off steam. There were brothels and saloons, those kind of things. A lot of times, farmers and cowboys did not get along. The cattle trampled the fields. The farmers fenced off the land. They didn't get along all the time. Last thing we'll talk about real quick for the last 30 seconds here is mining. We'll talk about mining in class, but people also moved west for mining. There were tons of mines that were found in the West, and they would find these lodes. Lodes are just these big veins of ore, especially gold and silver, that could be made into money. And so California in the 40s, Colorado in the 1850s, and in Nevada there was called the Comstock Lode by Reno. And it created these huge boom towns. Some survived, some didn't. Some of these boom towns became ghost towns later on. and we'll talk about this in class, guys. So please don't forget your notes to do Thursday, September 18th. Make sure you guys do your summary and participate in class for our notes. Thanks.